Good morning. Take your hymnals, please. Turn to number 79, and please stand.
Thank you. Is everybody glad to be here?
Yes.
I hope so. I don't think there's any other place I'd rather be than right here, right now. So it's good to have everybody here. And if you're a visitor and you'd like to get in contact with Pastor Mike, feel free to do so. But we appreciate having everybody here. And it's going to be, I hope you're here for a blessing, because God will pour them out today for sure. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Father, we come to you today, and again, thank you for this day that you've given to us, that we can lift your name on high and glorify you through what we say, what we do, Lord. Father, we just ask that you would be over this service today. We ask for a hedge of protection, as we know that the evil one wants to come and distract and destroy what is going to be said today, what is going to be taught and ministered to our hearts, Lord. Father, I ask that you would please prepare our hearts for the message at hand. I pray that you give Pastor Mike recall and give him the power to speak your words. Father, I pray that you be glorified today. We thank you for all that you do in our lives. Each and every blessing that you pour out into our lives, we thank you for it, Lord. Father, we know that there's many people hurting with health issues or whatever they may be, Lord. We ask that you meet them at their time of need. And Father, just ask that you'd be with our country, as we know that our country is in turmoil and turning away from you and what you would have us to do, Lord. And Father, help us to stand strong as believers in Christ. Stand up for the things that we need to stand up for, and to glorify your name no matter what it costs, Lord. Father, we ask that you'd be with Israel. And Father, just be with them in their turmoil that they're going through over there, Lord. Put your hand of protection upon them in that situation. Father, again, thank you for this day that you've given to us, that we can glorify you and let you be praised in it. We ask these things in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. You may be seated. As of announcements today, of course, we have the Hot Wheels Derby. And I know, I trust that all of you've been gearing up for those, got your engines tuned up and your tires changed, and hopefully not too many pit stops, because that could cost you dearly if you go into the pits, all right? So hopefully you got your wheels all ready to go and ready for that. So that's going to be a good time. That's going to be following after today's service. So don't forget about that. That will be down in the church basement. And of course, there's a little incentive there. If you brought some friends, maybe you could get that $25 gift card. And so be mindful of that. Of course, there will also be devotions and snacks at that time. So feel free to go down there and enjoy that time. Also, today is Natalie Siebenaler Sunday, so there is a basket back there for anything that you would like to give for that, so be mindful of that. Also back there, there is prayer sheets, so make sure that you're picking up a prayer sheet and then praying over the situations that are at hand in this church. It's very vital that we do that as believers. It's all out there. Not saying that you have to pray over that all in one day, because it's kind of extensive, but please take one and just pick out a few each day and pray over those needs. And as we do that as collectively as a body of believers, I mean, God moves mountains, doesn't he? We need to be faithful and be praying for the needs right here in our church. Also, March the 6th, there will be breakfast at the Four Seasons at 9 o'clock. March 6th also will be a prayer meeting in Christ Seekers at 7. And March 9th, the ladies' Bible study at 10 a.m. in the church basement. And then also March 10th, there will be a short business meeting following the morning service. And then also, don't forget, next week, anybody like waking up early? All right, a few hands, not too many. Yeah, got to be ready. Next week is, we got to get up a little bit earlier. So be mindful of that, the time change. So, and then also down there at the bottom, the 50th anniversary of Paul and Pat Lillard, Ledger. And that will be at the St. Paul Methodist Church, March 16th at 2 o'clock. So if you'd like to attend that, that would be in Montpelier there on Broad Street. If you'd like to attend that, there it is for you. So happy anniversary, Paul and Pat, for 50 years. Wow. Is there any other announcements at this time? Anything? All right. Any birthdays? Jackie and Glenn Pels celebrating 51 years. And I'm sure you've said or told us many times before, but I mean, was it love at first sight? Neither one. So how did this connection come together then?
I called and asked my roommate for a date, and she didn't want to go. So then he said, is Jackie busy? And I go, absolutely not.
Then it took me 3 years to get a date.
See, Pastor, we should not pry into this because we get ourselves in trouble, so.
Tell that story as a year to it. It only took
him
about 6 years.
Colleen, I think we're ready.
What a charmer, Glenn. If you take your hymnals again, turn to number 95 and please stand.
Hallelujah, God,
Seated, and at this time, Justin Siebenaler has a special.
Good morning. As I was preparing for this song, it made me think how often we face questions throughout our days. We have to ask them, we have to answer them. Some are hard, some are easy. The name of this song is Who Am I? If I ask that question to any of you, it's easy. I'm Jim and Colleen's boy. I'm Dina's husband. I'm Hope and Natalie and Leah's dad. But what if I ask myself, who am I? It's a lot harder to answer that. What if any of you had to ask yourself, who am I? More important, how would we answer that question in God's eyes? Who am I in God's eyes? Ephesians 43:1 says, "But now, thus says the Lord that created you and formed you, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." In this song, it asks a question, who am I? And it simply answers, I am yours.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me with love and watch me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. I am yours.
Thank you so much, Justin. I appreciate that. That's wonderful stuff. At this time, Junior Church is dismissed.
And there goes the stampede. That's a good sound to hear. For those of you who might like to know, Jerry Lemon now is in Evergreen Nursing Home in room 128. When you go in, you take a left, go all the way to the nursing station, take a right, and just keep walking. And it's just about the last room on the left, all the way down. But just so you know that. And thank you, Drew, for last week for covering for me. I appreciate that. I've heard a lot of good things about his ministry. You appreciate Brother Drew this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
Absolutely. I appreciate him, too. He does a fantastic job. Well, we want to continue on this subject we've been talking about. We've been talking about the home, and today we're going to title it Training Up a Child. How many have children or have had children? It's a job, isn't it? It's a big job, training up a child. You're training a life. You're training a soul. You're training a little one that the Bible says they are really the Lord's. He has extended them to us, entrusted them into our hands, and we need to be found worthy of training up that child. Now, we've been in the book of Ephesians. We've been in various places. But let's go back to the book of Ephesians this morning, chapter 6, to draw a little bit of a foothold to get us going this morning in the message. And we want to reestablish a little bit of what we've already talked about, because what we've talked about in the past that applies to the husband and the wife certainly applies to the child in the home. Isn't it strange how there are some homes that the children run the home? That's a disaster, isn't it? That's a disaster just waiting to happen. That's not the way God meant it to be. Now, they're going to try as hard as they possibly can to give you every reason under the sun, using their childlike ways to express to you as why they ought to be running your home. But God didn't ordain it that way. God ordained structure within the home. There's structure within the marriage, and there's structure within the responsibilities within that marriage, as well as children to their parents in the home. And the Word talks about that. And if we neglect what the Word teaches, we have nobody to blame if we raise a bunch of little rebels that we turn loose one day when they're about 18, 19. They go out into the world and they've never learned that they cannot rebel and get away with it. That's what's running our land today, is a bunch of rebels. Amen? That's what's running our land today. Apparently, they never were taken to the woodshed. They ought to have been raised in the home that I was raised in. Woo-wee! They would have been in the woodshed a lot. Some of you probably don't even know what a woodshed is. You're young enough not even to know what a woodshed is. Well, a woodshed used to be a place where they kept wood in the woodshed, right? Obviously. Well, in my day, when I was young, we had a building called the woodshed. It didn't have, well, it might have had some wood in it, but it wasn't wood for the wood burner or anything like that. But it's become synonymous with a place where you go to get a little bit of correction, correction on the seat of knowledge, right? And that's important. I found that I got correction in the seat of knowledge wherever the occasion occurred. That, for me, that's the way it was. But if you never learn respect and you never learn to honor your parents and ultimately to honor Almighty God, when you leave the home, you're going to leave the home thinking the world owes it to you. The world doesn't owe you nothing. Now, there's these radicals out there in high places that are leading our nation that would have you to believe that they that you have the right to think that way, but that's not right. That's not what God and His Word teaches us. He doesn't teach that at all. Where do they learn to live right, think right, and act right? They learn it in the home. Who do they learn it from? They learn it from their mom and dad, who are in connection, in communion with Almighty God, and is walking in obedience to His Word. So for several weeks, we've been talking about this marriage and the structure of the home. And the word that comes up when you talk about that, invariably it comes up, and oftentimes it comes up with a worldly connotation too, as the word is submission. Well, we look at it sometimes from the standpoint of the woman's responsibility to her husband, but really when you read the Word of God, there is a submission that the man has to Almighty God. And when he's submitted to Almighty God, he has a responsibility for his wife to love and honor and to lead and to shepherd and to nurture his home. And if he will do those things, his wife will naturally gravitate toward the leadership that God has established. God has established structure within the home. He's established structure within the church. We learned that the wife is to be the helpmate. She was created to be his companion. She was created from Adam. From what? From a rib. And what kind of a rib was it? Prime rib. You better believe it was a prime rib. So every time you go to the restaurant and you order prime rib, you can think, look across the table at your wife and say, I got a good wife. Amen? I got a good wife. She was created, the first woman was created from prime rib, from a rib of Adam. And God created her for Adam to be a companion. She was created to be a helpmate, and she was given to Adam. And notice what the Bible says. We're going to come back to Ephesians chapter 6. I was going to use that as a text, but I got sidetracked. But we'll get back here in just a minute. Go with me back to Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 22. Watch what it says in Proverbs chapter 18. Hope you brought your Bible this morning, because if you came to church without your Bible, you don't have your sword and you're not prepared, are you not? Proverbs chapter 18, verse 22. Watch what the word says here. The Bible says this in Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 22. He says, whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtaineth the favor of the Lord. Turn to your wife and say, I found a good thing. Boy, it sure is quiet. I found a good thing. Betty, I sure found a good thing. You better believe it. A long time ago, up there in the high school, upstairs in the study hall, there she was. Oh, yes, sitting right behind me. And she was talking to Hugh Lesnett. How many remember Hugh Lesnett? Yes, sir. She was talking to Hugh Lester. She and Hugh had a thing going. And I turned around to say, what in the world is going on? I'm trying to study. Hello, hello, hello. How are you today? Pleased to meet your acquaintance. And yes, from that point on, yes, sir, she broke a date with another guy who lives not too far down the road. He wasn't too happy with that. She broke a date with him to go with me, and it's been love ever since. Praise the Lord for that. I found a good thing. Turn to your wife and say, I found a good thing. Absolutely. And that's what should be when we find that wife that God has ordained for us. Now, remember, we talked about that. We think we have found them because we find this woman there. We're attracted to them. But if we're born-again believers in Jesus Christ, that's the way it should be. Born-again believer in Jesus Christ, we should gravitate to that man or that woman who is a born-again believer in Jesus Christ. And we learn that God, under the old Jewish ways, the father found the wife for his son. Okay? Well, God has ordained a plan where a wife he had in store for each and every one of us men and a husband for each and every one of you women, providing the fact you're a born-again believer and you listen to the leading of the Holy Spirit, he will lead you to that person that he has ordained for you so that you can say, as Proverbs says, I have found a good thing. And she completes him. Now watch what it says back in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 28. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 28. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. Where did the first wife come from? She came from the rib of Adam. Why wouldn't you love that rib that was departed from your rib cage that became your wife? Well, the Lord says that we're to love our wife as our own body. As men, we ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. She completes him. Notice what 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 9 says. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 9, it says this. Neither was the man created for the woman, but the woman for the man. So we started there initially as we've been talking about this whole marriage thing. And we said that this woman and this man, this woman, she completes him. This is talking about a spiritual union between the man and the wife created by God between two people. That's why when adultery enters into the marriage, it wars against that which God has created. The Bible says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. God wants to build a house. God wants to build a home with your life and with your marriage. Now, today we're talking about training up children. Go with me back to what we was going to read a few moments ago until I got windy and got sidetracked. Ephesians chapter 6, it says this, verse 1, children, do you see this, young people? How many young people do we have in the sanctuary this morning? Somebody below the age of 20. You're a young person. Well, there's a lot of people that are young people when I look at them today. Anybody below the age of, I'm not even going to tell you, but anyway, they look young. But anybody below the age of 20, raise your hand. Come on, raise your hand. Don't be bashful. Andrew, get your hand up. All right. Jackie, yes, you are. Absolutely. I learned something about you and Glenn this morning. I didn't know that. Glenn called for a date to go with your roommate, and well, is Jackie there, I'll go with her. You better believe it. But you found a good thing, brother. Amen? Amen? Amen. Good deal. All right. In Ephesians chapter 6, it says, young people, listen to what it says. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, that thou mayest live long on the earth. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. You know, it says fathers, and I think it's certainly aimed at the head of the home. There's no question about that. But let's remember one thing. We are one flesh, are we not? As husbands and wife, we walk as one. One doesn't walk ahead of the other. We walk as one. She's not at your feet. She's not your puppet. She's not your slave. You walk together, and the two of you together. But he addresses this to fathers because I believe fathers are going to stand one day at the judgment seat of Almighty God, the judgment seat of Christ, and they're going to give account for their homes. They're going to give account for their shepherding of their home, of their children, for being what God ordained them and called them to be to their home. They're going to have to one day stand and give an account of that. And you fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So we're studying about training a child. How does it begin? Well, it begins, obviously, with a marriage. There are statistics that I've read and I've written in my notes someplace, and I'm not seeing it right now as I'm looking for it. But I believe if I remember correctly, yes, here it is. There are 18 million. I didn't check which year that stat was put up. But approximately 18 million children today living without fathers in the home. That home is not the way God ordained it to be. And I don't say that. If you happen to be in that situation, I don't say that in a mean-spirited way. I don't mean it that way. But I'm just simply saying God ordained the home to be a father and a mother in the home. And it begins with a marriage. It begins with a marriage that's a Christian marriage. And it begins with structure in that marriage that is laid down on the foundation of God's word. And we see that back in Ephesians chapter 5 as Paul teaches that. We see that back in the book of Genesis as God lays down the first plan for the marriage. But in Ephesians chapter 5 verse 21, what does he say to you and I as husbands and wives? Submitting yourself. There's that word again. Now the world will take that word submitting and they'll just, you listen to the ladies on The View, if you give that word to the ladies on The View, I guarantee you they would destroy it. But that's not the way God meant it to be. God meant it to be a glorious thing. Because it's like I've told you before, like the communion table, the elements on the communion table preach a message of what the love of God and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and the hope that we have as a believer is that one day he's coming back again, and the bread is the bread of life which sustains us as we live here in this world, but it's the hope that we have of him coming back again. So every time we take the Lord's table, it preaches that message. Well, by the same principle, our marriage, God ordained our marriage, preaches a message. It preaches the oneness that we ought to have one with another. We're committed to the same goal. In a marriage, there is structure just like in our relationship with Jesus Christ. For example, when we pray, how do we pray? We pray in Jesus' name. Is it a magic potion when we pray in Jesus' name? No, it's not a magic potion, but we pray that way. We pray that the glory of God might be fulfilled when we pray. We don't want to pray selfishly. We want to pray in the will of God, and we pray in the name of Jesus. Jesus is our advocate. You just don't strut into the throne room of Almighty God and say, here am I. Yes, you've been redeemed, but how were you redeemed? You were redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. He is your advocate. He is your go-between. And so, therefore, you make your request in the name of Jesus Christ. That request ought to glorify the Father. But you see structure. And there's structure in the marriage. There's structure in the relationship that we have with the Heavenly Father. God established structure in the Godhead. We talked about that in the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is committed, is a servant, if you will, is yielded to the Son and yielded to the Father. Yet the Son is yielded to the Father, and yet they're one. They work as one. They each have a distinct ministry, a distinct oneness, and they work as one in the Trinity. In the church, there is structure. There's the pastors. There's the elders. And we try to walk together, and we want to serve the Lord. We want to do what's right for the Lord. But one day, at the judgment seat of Almighty God, I will give an account for what takes place in this pulpit. And you bless your gizzard, I better preach what the Word of God has to say, or I'm going to have my go to the woodshed again, right? And be chastised for that. There comes accountability. So here in the body of Christ, husbands and wives have divine roles to fulfill to each other as we submit to Christ. When we obey His Word, it gives purpose to our union and direction for the next generation. Now the Bible says here in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, children, obey your parents. They're looking at their parents. They're watching their parents. They're learning from their parents, what their parents say, how their parents react, the character of their parents. They're learning as much as you bring them to church and they come and hear the Sunday school teacher and hear the scriptures taught. And the Sunday school lessons taught. And those things are all well, good, and fine. And they should be taught. But when you go home, in the privacy of your home, they're learning from their parents. Children, it says, obey your parents. And they will obey your parents, their parents. They will mimic their life after their parents many times. Here it says, obey your parents. There's a lot of scripture that speaks to that end. Let me give you just one or two, if I may, this morning. Go back with me to Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1. And maybe one of these Sundays we're going to come back and just do a little bit of time in the book of Proverbs. Oh, it's just a tremendous book. in the Old Testament. It's a great place to have devotions from if you're concerned about teaching and training and your children, because in these Proverbs, it gives you so much to draw off of to teach your children. Young people, listen to what the Word says. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 1, my son, hear. Now, that also includes daughters, too, so don't just think because you're a girl, you get out of jail card. It doesn't mean you. Yes, it does you. My son, hear the instruction of thy father, and forsake not the law of thy mother. Go with me to Proverbs chapter 6, verse 20. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 20. My son, keep thy father's commandment and forsake not the law of thy mother. Can I say something to you, young people? When you go to school and with your worldly friends, perhaps you have some worldly friends, and that's not all bad. You witness to them. You can invite them to Sunday school. You can invite them to church, and maybe they can become Christian friends. But sometimes you hear your worldly friends say things like this, well, my old man. You ever heard your worldly friends say, my old man? Do you know what that name, my old man, stands for? That's a name for the devil. Don't ever dishonor your mom or your dad by calling him the old man, or your mother, the old lady. And let me say to this, I'm going to pry a little bit here. If you happen to be dating, maybe you're a girl and you go to the boyfriend's house and you hear the boyfriend's dad call his wife the old lady. Drop him like a dead beef. I don't care how good looking he is. I don't care how athletic. I don't care how smart he is. Drop him like a dead beef, because one day he'll call you his old lady. That's not the way you treat your wife. That's not the way you reverence your wife. That's not the way you honor your wife. You see, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, children obey your parents, and those children will obey their parents. They will do what they see and what they hear. If you don't honor your wife, or you don't respect and honor your husband, the old boar's nest, why do I got to follow him around? Why do I got to wash his socks? When you talk him down in the presence of your daughters, your daughters will do the same thing one day when they have their own home. When you and I learn to honor the Word of God and what the Word of God has to say in our home, God has a way of bringing back a blessing into our home. Here it says, children, obey your parents. This is said in view of what he's already said in chapter 5, verses 21 through 33, when he's instructing your parents how they need to submit to one another under Almighty God's banner that he has over us. Remember, we talked about that. Jehovah Nissi, the Lord is my banner. The nation of Israel came under the banner, under the law of God. The oneness of that law directed their life. And when you and I, as a born-again believer, marry a man or a woman that's a born-again believer who is submitted to the Word of God, you come under the banner of his Word. How important is that? Well, Ephesians chapter 5, Paul is teaching the church, this is what needs to happen if you want the favor of God, the blessing of God upon your church. Now, why? Well, look what he says back in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. When you're filled with the Spirit, you're going to walk in obedience to the Word of God. You're going to walk in obedience to the Word of God. Notice what it says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. It says, for this is right. When you are obedient, when you honor your father and your mother, this is right. You are honoring God because you walk in obedience to his word. Now, how long do I honor my parents? Well, you know, I'm 20 years old. I got my own car. Boom, boom. Wind her up, tack her up, blow her out. GTO. I got my own car. I got a job. I might have an apartment. I don't need to honor my parents no more, right? That's not what the Word teaches us. Listen to what it says in Proverbs chapter 23. One of these Sunday mornings, I want to preach on old people. Oh, that's a great subject, let me tell you. Old people. You watch them. They make funny noises, funny sounds. They say funny things. Their teeth make funny noises sometimes. In Proverbs chapter 23, Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 22. Look, watch what it says, young people. Hearken unto thy father that begot thee, and despise not thy mother when she is old. Well, they're not up to speed. I mean, they don't know how to work the internet, and they don't know how to work these cell phones, and they don't hear, all they ever do is say, huh? I know. But the Bible says you're to honor them. You're to love them. Because let me tell you something, sweetheart. You're going to get there one day, too. One day, your step is going to change, too. One day, you're going to stand in the mirror and go like this. It's going to be flabby-labby. Not going to be the prettiest thing you ever seen in your sight, in your life. And you're going to say, how in the world did I ever get that way? And then you're going to have your next birthday, and then you're going to know how you got that way. You got old. But the Bible says to young people, honor them. You're to love your parents. You're to honor your parents. That's an important thing. That's how long do you do it? You do it as long as they're alive, and even after they're gone, you still continue to honor them. You honor your parents. Why? Look what it says in chapter 6, verse 2 of Ephesians. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment, with promise. Now, there's a lot that goes into this, but just run back to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 5, and verse 16. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Revelation, right? No. Deuteronomy, chapter 5, and verse 16. Listen to what it says. Honor thy father and thy mother as the Lord thy God hath commanded thee. Watch this, young people. Watch this, young adults. That thy days may be prolonged, and that it may go well with thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Why should you honor your mother and your father? Why should you honor your parents? Why should you honor old people, your old grandparents, your old mom and dad? Why should you honor them? Well, one of the things is longevity. Your longevity. Your life could be cut short. If you choose to be a radical rebel, your life could be cut short very easily. And the blessing of Almighty God could be withheld from you. The idea behind this, though, is our submission. It is we perpetuate Christianity, not just with our words, but with the lives that we live. And that can only happen, first of all, once we've been redeemed and come to Christ and then surrender to Him, and we do what we're supposed to do with our lives. The Bible says we'll become the salt of the earth. What is wrong with America? Because we aren't sending salt into America from our homes. The salt has lost its savor. We have allowed our children to teach us and tell us what we ought to do. That's not the way God ordained it. God demands in His word that we teach and we train their will. We teach and train them to love and to honor the Lord. Notice what He says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 3. He says that it may be well with thee, that thou mayest live long on the earth. Your future will be much more difficult in this world if you fail to honor your parents. It's a proven fact that children without parents who love and teach and train them, their lives, they suffer greater hardship, greater difficulty. They suffer greater failures in life simply because they did not have that. The home is a learning center where we perpetuate the future homes that will lead our church, that will lead our nation. And then notice what He says in chapter 6, verse 4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Provoke means to push them away from Christ. My example, my character, my unfaithfulness, my disobedience is teaching them to be disobedient. I can push them away from Christ. Provoke is asking something of them they are not capable of attaining. Your children will never be perfect. Look in the mirror. You're not. I'm not. Don't give them something that they are incapable of attaining and then criticizing them to no end because they don't meet your expectations. God doesn't do that with you. God doesn't give you any more than you can bear. He gives you what you can handle. He's a loving Heavenly Father. Provoke is setting them up to fail in life. Fathers, you and I are extension of the heart of God. I heard it said before that fathers are like the conduit through which the life of the Heavenly Father, the love of the Heavenly Father, flows to the child. Now it says in verse 4, it says, fathers, bring them up, is speaking to the heart that loves like a father in heaven loves. What is the sole goal of the Father in heaven? That you and I come to heaven to live with him. That ought to be your goal and my goal as an earthly father. Number one, to bring them to Christ. How do I bring them to Christ? Well, I'll tell you how I bring them to Christ. I never bring them to church, right? That's the wisdom of this world. No, you want them to come to Christ. You put them in a position where they can hear the claims of Christ. You do it in the home. You bring them to church where they can hear the claims of Christ. You teach them so they can grow in godliness. And then you cultivate within that heart and life so they can learn to make good choices, good decisions. And that's where the book of Proverbs comes in. Tremendous book. The writer of Proverbs says to his son, he says, My son, hear the instruction of thy father. Forsake not the law of thy mother. And one day he takes his son out. He takes him out down the city street. And he says, look down the street. See that guy going down this street, son? I think it's about Proverbs 6, Proverbs 7, somewhere in there. He says he's going down that street. And you see that woman out there on that street? And look how she's dressed. And look how she's presenting herself. She's presenting herself to that guy so he tried to attract him to her. She's going to use him. And he needs to have the discretion within his own heart and life that he can make good decisions and not fall into that trap like Joseph of old did. Joseph of old found himself thrown into that situation, not because he chose to go there. But when it came to him, he had the inward discretion on the inside of him that he could walk away from it. And that was a hard walk. But because he feared Almighty God, because of his upbringing, he was able to do that. That's what the father teaches his son. He cultivates within that son that wherewithal to know the difference between good and evil, to know how to make right decisions. Will he always make right decisions? No. Sometimes we still make bad decisions. He teaches them to accept responsibility. The father is the conduit through which the love of God flows to his home and to his children. The heart of the father loves his children. Your example will teach them. Your character will lead them. Let me read something to you. I came across it this week. This is called A Grimm's Fairy Tale. It tells us about an old man who lived with his son and daughter-in-law because he had nowhere else to go. The old man's hands trembled. When he ate, he clattered the silverware. He often missed his mouth with his spoon and dribbled some of the food on the tablecloth. The daughter-in-law hated having him there because he interfered with her right to happiness. So she and her husband took the old man and gently, firmly led him to a corner of the kitchen where they set him on a stool and gave him his food in an earthen bowl. From then on, he always ate in the corner, blinking at the table with a wistful eye. One day his hand trembled more than usual. He dropped the bowl and it broke. And the daughter-in-law said, if you are a pig, said the daughter-in-law, you must eat out of the trough. So they made him a little wooden trough. And he got his meals in that trough. This couple had a 4-year-old son. They were quite fond of, naturally. One night the father noticed a boy playing intently with some bits of wood. He asked what he was doing. The boy said, I'm making a trough. He said, smiling for approval, to feed you and mama out of when I get big. The man and his wife looked at each other for a while and didn't say anything. And then they cried a little. Then they went to the corner and took the old man by the arm and led him back to the table. They set him in a comfortable chair and they fed him with his dinner on a plate. And from then on, nobody scolded him when he clattered or spilled or broke things. Honor your father and your mother. Even when they're old, even when their hands shake, you are a reflection of the heart of Almighty God. I will assure you the heart of Almighty God loves that old man or that old lady. He loves old people. He loves children. The heart of the father, though, this morning, dear friend, is under attack, does it not? The devil is doing all he can to attack and to undermine our devotion. How is he doing it? He's doing it through hobbies. He's doing it through our jobs, through our work, through our friends, through sports, through worldliness. You don't believe that? Go back and read 2 Timothy chapter 3. In the last days, perilous times shall come. What does it say? For men shall become lovers of their own self. What has happened? The devil is undermining the heart of the father. Here it says in verse 4 of chapter 6, ye father, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. The heart is the place where life gets its direction. And we need to take care of our heart this morning. The first and great commandment is, love the Lord your God with all your soul and with all your heart. I want to ask you a question this morning. How much do you love the Lord? How much do you love the Lord? Are you submitted to him? Are you yielded to him? Are you striving to be obedient to him? Have you established an altar within your home where you spend time with your family and take the word and just read a little bit and pray with your children every day where they see that example lived out in the home daily? So important, so important. Perhaps you're here this morning. Maybe you have a profession of faith in knowing Jesus Christ. But maybe you haven't been living the life you ought to be living. You know that. Spirit of God speaking to your heart, banging on the door of your heart right now, saying you need to change a few things in your life. Maybe you need to come to the altar and just spend some time with the Lord. Or maybe right there in your pew. Maybe you're here this morning and don't know the Lord as your personal Savior. We would like, first and foremost, to lead you to Christ. You can't begin to live the kind of life that you ought to live and be the father you ought to be until you, first of all, know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And we'd like to show you how to be a Christian. Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Father in heaven, this morning, we thank you for the word. Thank you for what you teach us from the word this morning. The great responsibility that is ours, of teaching and training our children, to making our home a place where the word of God is proclaimed and where our children can see an example and be taught and be brought up. We're reminded of that verse of scripture, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he won't depart from it. Father, we believe it begins in the home. You clearly taught us that this morning from your word. Perchance this morning, Father, there are those in our midst today that are not living out what you have taught us from your word. And maybe today they need to recommit themselves, their home, to you and allow you to be first and foremost in their home. That might mean they might have to lay aside some things that they've been doing. Change a few things, a few habits in the home to make time each day where they can look into the word. Because these children, the scripture says, are the heritage of the Lord. They have been entrusted to us. And if they leave our homes and we haven't taught them, we haven't prepared them, and they leave our homes and they're not salty, but they're unsalty, Father, that'll come back on us. I pray that you'll speak to hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. Take your hymnal this morning, turn to page 389, and let's all stand.
Thank you. growing up.
As young couples, young families, not having that time, that short time, it doesn't have to be a long time, but spending time with your family where you decompress at the end of the day. And the best place I think to go to start is Proverbs. It's just a great book to start reading. You don't have to read many verses, and the Lord will speak to your heart as the shepherd of your home. You have that which you can teach your children with. If we don't do that, we're failing our children. We absolutely have got to do that and pray with them. Don't let a night go by that you don't pray over your children. You might come home from work for some reason late, and they might have gone off to bed. Wherever their bedroom is, downstairs, upstairs, you go into that room and you pray over them every night. Don't let a night go by that you don't pray over your kids. Amen? Amen. That's important. Do that. And the blessing of God, I believe, will be on that home if you'll be obedient to that home. Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Tyler, would you close in prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the ability to come together and to worship you. Thank you for this message that each and every one of us that are parents or that are kids, that are grandparents, whatever we might be, that we know that we have a responsibility to the next generation, to teach them up and to raise them in the way that you see fit. They can be beacons of light in our dark world we have today. We thank you for the ability to come together, and we ask that you be with us in our separate ways and give us traveling mercies and bring us back in the next point in time. We ask all these things in your name. Amen.